So in this course, for the moment, we just have seen ergodic theories. So let's now go to foliations. Indeed, when we start to this subject at the end of the last century, if I'm not wrong, what we had in mind was precisely the question that Nissen solved yesterday, that is, to look at the foliation in CP2 and assuming some genericity about the singularities and something like that to see what is the meaning of to do ergodic theory with this holomorphic foliation on CP2. But as Nissen told yesterday, there is some theoretical problem for applying ergodic theory about what is the good notion of measure for foliation. So let me start with that. Now I look at a manifold M on the higher foliation, and so the easier foliation you can imagine are of dimension 1. For the moment, for me, I know that it's real foliation, not complex one. That is, when I put dim 1, that is dim 1 over R, that is a foliation up to an orientation. I have some vector field X on M, a vector field. So vector field generates by each point, you have the solution of the vector field, which is the leaf of the foliation, which is a one-dimensional leaf, and you have the flow, I will denote it FT, the T in R, the flow of X. That is, if I have a point X here, I have here FT of X. And so if I want to build invariant measures, it's at a very good meaning. It's a measure is, I think I have some echo, so I think that someone is speaking and it's me. Okay. So an invariant measure is a measure which is invariant for all the FT. And so that is easy to build. You look at X, you look at the segment of orbit that I will denote F0T of X, this segment of orbit. So on this segment, you have a natural measure which is just DT. That is, you just look at the velocity of your orbit on this segment, so you have this natural measure, but it's not a probability, so you can look at, so mu t of x is 1 over t dt restricted to f 0 t of x, okay? And exactly as we have seen for the diffeomorphism or homeomorphism or maps, if you look at now any accumulation point, any limit, so mu t n of x tend to mu is invariant. Why it is invariant? So because you are taking a very large segment of orbit. So you have your x here, and you have your ft of x there. And if you apply, for example, the time 1 of x, so you look at the image of your measure, which is supported of this segment. You take the image by f1. So you have here f1 of x, and you have here f1 of ft t of x, that is ft plus 1. Okay? And so the difference of the two measures is this part and this part. But as you divide by t, it's very small, so this segment defines an almost invariant measure. All the limits will be invariant. Let's look at this limit, this measure, this invariant measure, in another way. Look at now what's happened in a flow box of your vector field. And so you take your segment of orbit, and your segment of orbit is cutting many times your flow box. You don't know how many times. And if you now you have some set on who you want to know, so that is your segment, you have some set and you want to know what is its mass for mu t of x, of this set, I don't know this set, this name, take A, so mu t x of A. What you will look at, you will look at in each of these segments, what is the length. So you will have these lengths, you will make the sum, and you will divide by t. That is the mass of A for this measure. You can do that other way. You can, it's the same way, but I will make just a little bit more abstract. So I take here some transverse section of my flow box sigma, and I look the intersection with the leaves which are here, and I put, at each point, I put, so let's put x1, x2, maybe x is not a good idea, z1, z2, z3 here, and I put the Dirac mass, Dirac z1, Dirac z2, and so on. And now, what I want for getting this mass, what I do is I look at, on each leaf, on each plaque, I look at the length of the intersection, so that gives me a function, which is, let's say, the length of A intersection with the plaque Z, with the plaque associated to Z. Okay, I look that, and now I make the integration of the length of A intersection with the plaque of height Z by my measure, which is by the measure d mu t de my flow box here, on this, sorry, I will put here a mu transverse t, on what is this one, on sigma, mu t transverse is the sum of the, of is 1 over big T, that is big T, sorry. The sum of the Dirac at the point ZI. Okay. I tell that for some T, I put some T large, and I tell, oh, I look that, it's cut many times, and it's what I do. It's a little bit wrong, because I have maybe this one, the one extremity was here. And so with that, it's not exactly that, because maybe it's not making the intersection with the plaque. But there is at least two plaques, which the first one and the last one. And so divided by T, I just don't care. Two plaques make a small mass. I divide by T, it's almost nothing. Okay, so this measure, which is just this Dirac, what happens if I take another chart, and I have another transversal, and I look at some pieces, which is send by holonomy from one to the other. If I take any, so I will get exactly the same measure for, that is, I will have here zeta z line something to z line 3, and the mass is always the same, the Dirac divided by t, that is, this measure is invariant by the holonomies. So that is a way for telling that my measure here looks like a measure which is just dt on the plaques. So here I just integrate dt on the plaques. And after that, I integrate by a transverse measure. So in fact, the limit is exactly like that. So in fact, if you look at mu, this measure, which is at this time invariant, so if you look at a flow box, and if you want to know what is the mass of some set A, then you look at for each Z, you integrate the characteristics function to that set along each plaque, and then you have to integrate to the limit of this transverse measure when t tends to infinity. So you have a measure, a transversal measure on this sigma. So you have here a measure mu, transversal, and the measure mu is obtained that, exactly by this formula. You make the integral of so is what I call the length of the intersection. You look at the length of the intersection of A with all of the plaques, and then you integrate transversely. And this measure, when you change the chart, will be invariant by all the holonomy maps that you will get generated by your foliation. Okay, so that is the one-dimensional case. So it indicates us what to do if you want to get a notion of invariant measure for foliation in higher dimension. So now, as it's easier to make picture in dimension 3, I will assume that the M is in dimension 3 and the dimension of F is 2, but it's the same in any dimension. So let's take some metric, Riemannian metric on M with some metric. So now, take your foliation, take some leaf, and for instance, take the disks around some point X in a leaf. And so you could think a good way for making the same of taking a big piece of an orbit here and to put dt is to take a big piece of your leaf, so let's call that delta. I put a disk, but it can be any region. You take delta region in the leaf of X, and you look at the area, because I take dimension 2, and the area is defined by because I have a metric. So you take the area, and you restrict it to delta. So that gives you a positive measure, but it's not a probability. So you divide by the total mass in order to get a probability. So let's call that mu delta of x. Oh, of x, no, mu delta. Okay. And so you take a big delta like that. So in fact, if you take, I have to take, I did not make any recurrence there, but you delta make many, many things. So if you look now at flow box, delta will cut the flow box, the foliated chart. Delta will cut, so foliated chart, you will have delta cuts the foliated charts in finitely many but many. I put the region compact. Finitely many plaques. Plaques is like in French, like that. Plaques in delta intersection with the foliating chart gamma, okay? And so you would like to do exactly the same, to tell, oh yes, if I want to see what is this measure about some set A, if I have some set A, if we cut these plaques, I will look at the area of the intersection on each of the plaques. So in fact, I can do that for all the plaques, and I will multiply by the transverse measure obtained exactly as that. That is, you divide by the total mass, and you put the Dirac on the plaques which are in delta. So if that procedure could work, it will tend to, if possible, some probability mu, which will be equal to integrated the area in the plaques times holonomy invariant transverse probability. Okay, we would be very happy with that, but here I told you, oh yes, it's not exactly true when I make that with T finite, because I have two plaques which maybe are not complete. And here, so I may have that the delta here just cut like that, or like that, and so on. And how many plaques, non-complete plaques, I have? That has to do with the relation between the length of the boundary of delta divided by those. That the length of the boundary of delta tell me more or less, make me a bounds of how many plaques will not be complete. Because each time I have a non-complete plaque, I have a part of the boundary. And if I divide by the area of delta, this tell me if, well, this problem of non-complete plaque is an important problem if I don't care. If that tends to zero, if I have a sequence of the, so if there exists if there exists a sequence of delta n such that the length of the boundary of delta n divided by the area of delta n tends to zero, then we do exactly as for the vector fields, and what we get is a measure which is the product of the area in the leaves by a transverse invariant measure. And that seems to be a good equivalent to the invariant measure, the exact equivalent to invariant measure for dynamical systems. However, so that these sequences are called Fellner sequences. And these kind of sequences always exist, and I think that I'm not good in historical things, but the first building transverse invariant measure, I think, for Plant, and he make a stronger assumption than that, which was that the growth of the ball, if you have that, the area of the ball of radius R is polynomial in R, then just take the big disk in the leaves, and you will have Follner sequences, so you will have transverse invariant measures. However, in the case that Nissen spoke yesterday, and that we also are interested, we look at foliations, holomorphic foliations, so the of dimension one. So the leaves are Riemann surfaces, and in fact they are hyperbolic Riemann surfaces. But you know that on the hyperbolic disks, the growth of the disk is exponential, telling that the length of the boundary is of the same, is the derivative of the volume, so it's also exponential. So you get that this limit will be one, I guess, or some constant at least. Okay. I'm not telling that this tells that there is no invariant measure for holomorphic foliations with hyperbolic leaves, just telling that it's not clear if there exists or not. So now let's go to examples. For the moment, you have seen foliation as, for some reason, some guy has some equation or some form or some, I don't know, and we have no idea of the dynamics, and sometimes it's not the dynamics which can be important, like in the course of José Victorio in the morning. But there is another procedure for having exactly the contrary. Take the dynamic and build the foliation. And that is a classical procedure. I don't know who have done that for the first, but which is called making a suspension. So it's foliation built by suspensions. And so I will explain what it is just now. But I think that most of you have seen at least the suspension of one diffeomorphism. So let me recall what is a suspension of one diffeomorphism. Suppose that you have a manifold F come fiber, as fiber, and you have a diffeomorphism F from F to F, and then there is a nice construction for building a foliation whose holonomy will be precisely this diffeomorphism. So you take F and you make F times 0,1, F times 0 here, F times 1 there. And you remember that the circle is like 0,1, so I prefer to put the circle there, and I will put 0,1 like that. I put my so let's go like that. So that is F times 0, and that is F times 1, which is here. Okay, so I just put this one, and I put like that. And now, if I have some point x, so I have x 0 here, I arrive to x 1 there, and I will glue it to, so I glue these two. I have a manifold with boundary, and I will close it by gluing this part of the boundary with this one by the identification of x1, this point, to f of x, 0. So we are looking 0,1 time f. I put all the reverse, but the horizontal are the first, okay? Zero one time f with the quotient that x zero is equivalent to f minus one of x one. Here it was x one is equivalent to f of x zero, which is exactly the same. Okay, but if I make this construction, you will understand that that gives you topological manifold, there is some difficulty to make it smooth. So let's make a more canonical construction on which prepare to making better, to generalize it. This space, you can see also like this. So, yes, notice that when I obtain that, it's no more an interval. What I get is a vibration over the circle. I have a vibration over the circle on the initial trivial vector field, the d over dt, that is the horizontal foliation. Now, when I make that, I arrive at the point f of the image. So the holonomy of that foliation on this complete cross-section is precisely my map f. So how you do that another way? You remember that the universal cover of S1 is R, and you look at R, so R times F, and you will identify X with T plus one, which is the automorphism, the generator of the automorphisms on the cover, with F minus one of X. Okay. On that, this identification, so you have a fundamental domain which is precisely that. On this fundamental domain, you have this unique identification. So it's more or less, it's, well, if you think sometime you will check that they are equal. And so here, now, it's more evident that we have a smooth structure on that we get a vibration on S1 because that exactly was making the quotient of R by the automorphisms of this cover. So we just repeat that construction with a more difficult group. So in fact, here I told you I made the suspension of F, so on one diffeomorphisms, and so now I want more than one diffeomorphisms, but here what is hidden is that F is in fact a group, and in fact it's each time I make a turn, I see F. If I make twice turn, I see f square. If I go in the other direction, I see f minus one. So it's, in fact, I have to see that as a representation of the fundamental group of S1, that is Z, in the set of diffeomorphisms. So let's make the same now. We have f, a fiber, manifold. You have b, another manifold, and you look at the fundamental group of B, and you look at a morphism from B to the diffeomorphism of F. We will suspend these morphisms. What means that? So I have my base B. I have the fibers on the, it's difficult to draw, so I will just put a square, but up to at each point you have its fiber. So if you have x here, you have here the fiber fx. So I have a fundamental group, so I have a base point here. So I take that it is precisely this point. And now what I want is some foliation, which will be transverse to the fibers. See, I have another fiber each time it's cut in one point. But if you make a path down, you can lift it in the leaves, which because they are transverse to the fibers, and you will get some path on the leaf on that point. So if that, so let, if that was the point x, that point will be precisely rho of gamma, that path gamma, rho of gamma minus one applied to x. So is what I want. Is what I want a foliation transverse to the fibers, and such that its holonomy are globally defined on the fiber above the, my base point here. And the holonomy is precisely given by the representation rho taking the inverse. How you do that? Just repeat exactly this. That is, you take B tilde projection on B, the universal cover of B. You have the natural representation of pi 1 of B, I will call that ot, which has in the automorphism of the covering P, which has gamma associated ot gamma, the corresponding automorphism of the covering. Okay? That this will replace my T map on T plus 1. And so what I look now is B tilde times F, and I take the quotient by the identification of a point Tx is equivalent to the point ot gamma of T rho gamma of X. That is an action of that is a product action of the group, of the fundamental group of B on this set. And this action preserves the horizontal foliation because the action on the fiber does not depend on the horizontal point. The action on X does not depend on T, so it maps an horizontal leaf on an horizontal leaf. That implies that when you take the quotient, the horizontal foliations, so the whose leaves are the B tilde times T, so these foliation go down in a foliation exactly as we want. So, okay. So if the first time you see this, it's a little bit complicated because you have to remember your courses on cover. But just think on that picture. That is, you have a base, you have a vibration over the base, and we want a foliation transverse to the fibers, such that the holonomy are given by a representation. By giving, so we fix the holonomy and then we build the foliation. So that is the suspension foliation. Okay. So that's an important construction for what's remained. So is there some question up to now? The here?
Yeah.
No, no, no. If you want an action, I take here real morphisms. But the holonomy, if you look at the holonomy of gamma sigma, you get the holonomy, the way of writing the composition, may holonomy of sigma composed with holonomy of gamma. That is, you reverse. The holonomy is a contravariant morphisms. So here I take a true morphisms. So the holonomy has to be the inverse. Okay? For that, when you take the suspension, you prescribe the inverse of your holonomy. Okay. So this allows us to make a lot of examples. And in fact, we will be especially interested in a very small class of this kind of examples. But cuando tú tienes un elemento del pi un abajo, hay una manera de cambiar los niveles de tu recubrimiento universal asociado a este. Entonces, una vez que fijas un punto base, piensa que lo llamas deck transformation, pero mi inglés es malo, entonces para mí es automorfismo del recubrimiento. Es deck transformation is
sí.
Okay, es este. Okay. For example, if you want that your basis, if B was the torus T2, and for instance, I will you take as a fiber S1 or CP1, so we can easily make examples with dense sleeves. If you want all the leaves are dense, for example, take one irrational rotation. So, oh yes, so here, what is the representation? So you have P1 of B is Z2. So a representation, rho, is just telling you two diffeomorphisms, F, G, in diff of your fiber, such that F, G is equal to GF. For example, take two irrational rotations and you will get dense leaves. So it's very easy to have foliation with dense leaves. If you want that they are holomorphic, just assume that you take here, I don't know, you take two irrational rotations on CP1 with different axes. You will get dense orbits. So it's also easy to get dense leaves for a foliation whose basis is T2 and the fiber is CP1, and that it would be an holomorphic foliation. If you want that not all the leaves are dense because it don't look so, everybody looks equal. So, for example, if you want dense leaves and one compact leaf, a compact leaf in that if you want to get a compact leaf, a compact leaf is some leaf which will cut this transversal in finitely many points. So for having a compact leaf, you just need that so here the fundamental group of B act on the fiber, so you can take the orbit of point in the fiber for the action of the fundamental group, just taking all the rho gamma of X, And if you want a compact leaf, you need that the orbit of X for the action of the fundamental group is finite. So for example, you take, if I want S1, and I want, so two different morphisms which commute on S1 with all the leaves are dense, just one is not dense, it's also easy. You take on the circle, you take a vector field with 1, 0, and you take F is equal, so use a vector field X, and its flow will be Ft, its flow, and you take F being X1, and G being X alpha for alpha irrational, and you take, and you, as I have, if you look at the group generated by these two diffeomorphisms on the circle, it's commute because they are in the, I put F, they're commute because they are time of the same flow, and the orbit will be dense because alpha is irrational, but you have a fixed point, which is the zero of the vector field. If you want that for holomorphic foliation on CP1, it's also easy. So, if you want an holomorphic foliation with fiber CP1, just take, for instance, one irrational rotation about one axis, and then you can have, make irrational, that will be F, and you can take for G, you can change an axis. You can make rotation which are not around two opposite points just by conjugacy, and so you can make also an irrational rotation like that, and you will have that all the so here it's a rotation around an axis which is not between two opposite points, but they share a same point, so you will have a fixed point, and it's not hard to see that you will have dense orbits. That all the other orbits, that this one will be dense. So you can have holomorphic foliation having several things. So in fact, here it was the abelian one. I don't know why I decide to see the abelian one. We are more interested with something which is more complicated. Now I will take S, surface of genus of S larger than 1. So my basis will be a surface of genus at least 2. Okay? So you certainly know that you have a base of generators. I will not draw it. You have a base of generator which is by pairs AIBI, with I go to the genus of S, and that the fundamental group of S is the group generated by the AI BI, but in AJ BJ, quotiented by the unique relation that the product of the commutators AI BI, A1 B1, is equal to 1. So that is our group. And now you look at representation rho from P of B in, and we will be interested in P SL to C, that is SL to C or P SL to C, the representation. And for just, I will just give two examples. No, the first one, I'm not able to be elementary, so I will forget it. So, sorry. There is an example of math. So, okay. take some two hyperbolic linear maps on SL2Z, which have two eigenvalues, which are hyperbolic, that is, which are two eigenvalues of modulus different than one, lambda on 1 over lambda. And so you have one point which is attracting, and one point which is repelling, and the dynamics go from one to the other. And you can take it such that, and you take some disk such that, so you can do that, such that you have that, here is your repeller, and you have some disk, and all which is not in that disk, all the complement of that disk, is sent in a small disk, so you have your repeller of F, here you have your attractor, okay, the attractor of F, and you have that all which is not in that disk around the repeller of F go inside the attractor of F. Then you choose, so that is for F. For G, you choose exactly the same, just you choose two disks which are disjoint for the first one. That is, for G, all which is not in that disk go inside this one. That forms what is called a Schottky group. I have no idea who you write Schottky, you can let me. S, C? Thank you. So that is called the Schottky group. Okay, so I choose two hyperbolic elements in SL2C, so that the action on CP1, which is the sphere S2, is like that. Okay, now this group is not so easy to get representation because you have to keep that relation. But there is some trick for avoiding this difficulty is that this surface you can project on two cycles intersecting in one point, sur un bouquet de cercles avec deux cercles, non, c'est comment on se dit. And that makes that P1 of S surjects on the free group with two generators. On the representation of a free group is the most easy things to do. You take two elements of the diffeomorphism without any relation. You don't care what it is. So I can send, so this one will send this element, for example, A on A here, B on B here. And then I will have here from in SL to C, the representation row, which send A to F, and B to G. And now my representation, so that will be row zero, and so the compose map will be my representation row. Okay. Now if you look at where are going the orbit for this kind of dynamics, each time you iterate, either you were in one of the disks or you go inside one disk. So when you iterate by some by element of the disk, you see you will be always in the image. But more than that, you were in some image and the next time you will be in an image, so you will be in the image of the disk. So, but if you take the image of this disk inside that, you get three disks. The first, this image, and this one goes there, and this one goes there. The same, if you take by F, you take the image, these three disks go inside here, and you take three disks there. And once more, here you have three disks like that, and so on. And now when you iterate, each of them, we have three disks and three disks and three disks. And so it's not hard to see that if you look at any limit of orbit, you will arrive to some contour set which is the limit of the which is the intersection of this nested sequence of disks. So here, as the Schottky group has a unique minimal set, which is this Cantor set, we get, by suspension, a foliation, so the suspension F rho, will have a unique minimal set, which is a transversely a Cantor. Transversely a Cantor. Cantor set. Okay. So, you see, and that is an holomorphic foliation. So even in the holomorphic class, we can make interesting dynamics. In fact, we can make very rich dynamics. And now for coming back to invariant measures, we have seen that if we want invariant measures, we need the invariant measure will be some the area in the leaves product a transverse measure which is invariant by all the holonomies. But here we know what are the holonomies. It's our group of diffeomorphisms. So this foliation admits an invariant measure if and only if there exists a measure, a probability measure on the fiber, which is invariant by all of the rho gamma. So here, for a, let's take, so here, that was F has one repelling point and one attracting point. So F was the gradient of some Morse, the time one of the gradient of some Morse vector field. And so the measure, the invariant measures were the two fixed points on any convex combination of them. Okay? For G, it was exactly the same. It was a repelling point here, an attracting point there. The invariant probability par G was the two fixed points and the convex combination of them. What are the invariant measures for the group? No one. If it was invariant, it has to be invariant by F. So it's one of these two points or combination by these two coefficients. But it has to be invariant by J, and it is not. Okay? Donc, the foliation here has no invariant measure, no transverse invariant measure. Okay? So let me state now the first result we had, and which will be the main result of this course. So, in fact, it was a first. It was for us a simplification of the problems that Nesin Siboni spoke yesterday. So that is, we wanted to understand ergodic theory for holomorphic foliation, having in mind foliation in CP2, but we wanted to avoid the difficulty of the singularities. Nesting yesterday spoke that there was some difficulty at the singularities, and we wanted to avoid that. So it was before the work of Siboni, so we didn't know that there was some solution like that. So we try simplification, but we wanted a rich dynamics. So this kind of suspension, the suspension of representation in SL2C, looks for us the first rich class where we could try to make ergodic theory. And in fact, there was already Lucy Garnett results which gave an answer to what could be the good measure for foliation. And the answer was harmonic measures, as Nessing built yesterday. But we were aware that exist, but I didn't know at all what was harmonic measure, and I didn't want to go in that way, which for me looks very analytical. So I wanted a geometric way. And so for me, to have a good notion that I will know where are going the leaves was to take, so let's come back to the, I have the foliation, and I want to say where are going the leaves. So I want to take one point X and to look at the ball inside the leaf, the ball. So I have my foliation, so is the ball inside the leaf, inside the leaf, center at X over radius R. To that ball, I will put a natural probability. So what is a natural probability? What I thought to be a natural probability is, as the leaf, we will consider as all a universal, I have here the leaf of X. So the universal cover of the leaf of X is the Poincaré disk. I take some lift here of X, so X tilde go to X. And here, I look at the ball around X of X tilde of radius R. Here, I have the natural probability mu X tilde R, which is the area, the hyperbolic area restricted to this ball. And that is not a probability because the total mass is the area of the disk. So I divide by I over the area of the total ball. Okay. And now I can push down this probability. So mu of XR is just the push down of mu of X tilde R. So that is a natural probability mu of XR. And initially, I would like that when R tends to infinity, this converges to some interesting measure. And, but I was also aware about the argument I told you about the Fellner sequences and the fact that for the hyperbolic disks, the growth was exponential, so that a priori it will be difficult to deal with the limit of this disk. However, we prove the following theorem. So let me, I don't want to. No, I have no more theorem. Okay. No more theorem, it disappears. So, let's draw, so B, S, an hyperbolic surface, that is a compact hyperbolic surface, that is a Riemann surface endowed with an hyperbolic metric. So it's so universal cover is a Poincaré disk with a Poincaré metric. On rho, a representation of the fundamental group of S in PSL2C. Okay. And so we get the suspension foliation F rho, the suspension foliation. Then, either F row admits a transverse invariant measure. That is, there exists a probability theta on CP1, which is invariant by all rho of gamma. So this case more or less never happen, because to get a probability which is invariant by a whole group, your group has to be very specific. I think that Bertrand gave a name for that yesterday, I guess. Non-elementary. Yes, so that is an elementary case. Okay.
But it can be a presentation to SO3. I mean, there's a representation of the fundamental, faithful representation of the fundamental group
to
SO3.
Okay.
And so this has an invariant measure, it's not elementary.
There is a premier point, it's an either. It rests an or. I was telling that is a case which never happened. That is a stupid case. The general case, no, it's not a stupid case. In fact, it can be interesting to study this one, but okay. Or, if you take any xn on any, it belongs to the foliation on a manifold MRO, xn in the ambient manifold MRO, for any rn tending to infinity, I have my or, there exists mu, a probability on MRO, such that, so there exists a probability on MRO, such that if you take any sequence of points on any sequence of radius tending to infinity, we have that mu of xn rn tends to mu. So this measure is the limit of any natural probability on the large disk on the leaves. So that was an exact equivalent to what's happened for vector field or for diffeomorphisms. We have a limit of the natural probability tending to one here. Okay? And so to. Okay, so that's the work with. Javier. And there are participations, because it's a list of papers. So there is, I have a paper with Javier. There is a paper with Javier and Ricardo Villa, which is also here. And there is a paper with Marcelo Viana. With Marcelo Viana. Okay, I think. No. No, no, Mathilde, no, no, era nacida. No, era nacida. Here, in this initial paper, we could also put two or three. We have result when the surface is not compact, but has finite volume. Now, with Amy Wilkinson, we can change by n with some, it's not exactly the same hypothesis there. But we can go to PSL nc. We can change the surface to any hyper, compact hyperbolic manifold. Okay, so we can do, so you have to make some small change of this hypothesis, but we get at the end the same kind of answer. And so in the next talk, I will try to show you the way we use for proving this result. And in fact, in comparison to what Nesin spoke yesterday, so he has an approach, because it's his field, from complex geometric complex analysis, and I'm more from real dynamical systems. And I think that in fact the idea, Nesin thinks that there is a complete dictionary that we could translate one proof to another and something like that. So certainly, I think it's always interesting when fields are crossing and you look at the intersection, you have many, many ways for doing the same. And for example, the result he published and he told us yesterday, we think we can reobtain in the way I will explain you next talk. So let me stop here.